Hear now these words from the book of Acts. On the day of Pentecost, all the believers were meeting together in one place. Suddenly, there was a sound from heaven like the roaring of a mighty windstorm, and it filled the house where they were sitting. Then what looked like flames or tongues of fire appeared and settled on each of them. And everyone present was filled with the Holy Spirit and began speaking in other languages as the Holy Spirit gave them this ability. Thus ends the reading of the Christian scriptures.
Yes. In the middle of the valley, God set down Ezekiel. There in the valley was Ezekiel. And with Ezekiel, there were bones. As far as the eye could see, little bones and big ones and medium ones, scattered, clumped, and piled up. It was the valley of dry bones.
In an upper room in Jerusalem, God gathered the followers of Jesus. There in the upper room were the disciples and the Marys and many others who believed in and loved Jesus. Nearly 100 total. They huddled together, lonely and afraid, locked safe behind strong doors from the perils of their world. It was an upper room of dry hopes.
In the 21st century, God had followers who called themselves Christians. There in the early 21st century lived Christians, and the Christians were Protestant and Catholic. There were Baptists and Methodists, Episcopalians, Presbyterian, and Assembly of God. And none of these groups were as big as they used to be. They were dwindling and shrinking, shriveling up before their leaders' eyes. It was a time of dry souls.
As Ezekiel walked the valley of dry bones, God suggested that Ezekiel prophesy to the dry bones. This strange request Ezekiel readily took up. In a valley of dry bones, Ezekiel began to speak God's word.
As the followers of Jesus huddled in an upper room, they remembered that Jesus had promised to send them the Holy Spirit. As unusual as this promise was, they believed. In an upper room of dry hopes, the followers waited for God's word.
As the Christians in the 21st century awoke to the state of their church, they began to try to figure out how and why it ever got that way in the first place. As fruitless as this endeavor was, the Christians still wanted to know why. In the time of dry souls, the Christians sought God's word.
With rattles and clacks and banging noise, the bones began to join themselves together. The toe bone joined the foot bone, and they in turn connected with ankle and leg bones, and so it was throughout the valley of dry bones. Limbs were attached to torsos. Long separated bones fit themselves back to one another. At long last, all the bones were put back in proper places, and each found its home. Then Ezekiel began to speak God's word and prophesy. Sinews came upon the dry bones. The bones were fleshed out, and skin covered it all. The new wrappings of the dry bones knit back together. God's word was powerful. In flesh, a valley of dry bones, giving them bodies once again. Yet, as Ezekiel saw, the valley was only filled with bags of dry bones. Though re-embodied, they were simply skin containers for the bones. In zombie fashion, blank eyes stared out of blank faces, unmoving.
Into the leadership vacuum left by Christ's ascension, Peter tried to step in. He kept the followers together. He reminded them that scripture had been fulfilled through the mighty acts they had witnessed. He reported the ultimate demise of Judas, the betrayer. Peter then led them in prayer that they might decide on another resurrection witness to join the discipleship band. that their number might return to 12. Matthias was chosen. Peter strived mightily to be their leader, but still, the disciples were afraid. Still, they waited for God's word. Still, they locked themselves away from the world behind strong, sturdy doors.
In keeping with the world's rapid pace, the Christians of the early 21st century began searching frenetically for a way to reverse their membership decline. They looked to the disciplines of psychology and sociology and big business and advertising. So they tried new programs and marketing strategies and targeted evangelism. They looked to mega churches and to small groups. They sought and sought a quick and painless way to maintain their status quo. They will borrow from any place, hastily brush on a gospel veneer, then give it a try. Many of these endeavors appeared to work or be successful, at least at first. And if one ignores the revolving doors on church fronts that let souls escape as quickly as new souls sought entrance, if one did not put the borrowed ideas to difficult stress tests that wore away the gospel veneer to reveal nothing underneath but emptiness, if one did not try to face personal crises with only pop psychology or the latest market trend to comfort them, they kept looking for God in all the wrong places in the time of dry souls.
As Ezekiel looked in amazement at the unpeopled bodies of bones knit together and re-enfleshed, he knew that life had not yet returned, that the bones were still dry. Then God suggested that Ezekiel prophesy for breath to come upon the dry bones. So Ezekiel again opened his mouth and prophesied, the breath of God filled that valley. The breath of God entered the bags of dry bones. The breath of God brought life. Now Ezekiel was in the valley of new life. Now hope came once again to Ezekiel and to the people to whom God sent Ezekiel to speak. The breath of God is the Spirit of God. The Spirit of God animated all the valley of dry bones.
Trapped by fear, the disciples waited. The upper room of dry hopes was a place on the edge of despair, trying to keep a stiff upper lip, trying to be patient in their waiting. Then, on the day of the festival of Shavuot, as the other Jews flocked to the streets of Jerusalem to go to the temple as the law required, that upper room of dry hopes was suddenly, spontaneously filled, full of a mighty wind that rushed and danced and permeated every little nook and cranny. Tongues of flame alighted on the heads of the huddled followers. The Holy Spirit entered each of them, filling them with new hope, empowering them to mighty deeds, ennobling them to great compassion. With the radiant glow of the Spirit shining in them all, they began to speak in many, many languages. They laughed and danced and shouted with joy. The noise of the Spirit drew a crowd. People leaned into the window that had been thrown open. They were greatly perplexed, for though they had come from all parts of the known world, this group of peasant Galileans were speaking all their native languages. The crowd of onlookers gave themselves over to speculation. Surely they had imbibed too freely from the fruit of the vine. Surely they were drunk. With his soul liberated, Peter leapt to a place of visibility and began to preach. The Spirit had And with great conviction, Peter began to share the good news of Christ's salvation, calling people to believe and repent, telling them of Jesus. He said that they were witness to the long ago foretold pouring out of the Holy Spirit to enable God's followers to dream and vision and prophesy. With such conviction that Peter preach, with such power did the Spirit continue to work on that very day. 3,000 people were baptized. 3,000! The mighty rushing wind was the Spirit of God, and it touched not only the frightened followers of Jesus, but many others as well. Dreams were born afresh, and God's Spirit transformed that upper room of dry hopes.
In the early 21st century, dry souls searched with great longing for meaning and fulfillment. Some turning to quick fix promises of new age gurus or the latest self-help book, A Better You in 5 Simple Steps, The Whole 30, Zumba, yoga. Some seek the root of distraction, and all are about pleasurable escapism through exotic travel or distracting hobbies. Some cling to familiar, comfortable traditions of days gone by, failing to see how hollow, stale rituals are in this day and age. Some stop searching altogether and slide down the slippery slope littered with despair and substance abuse and violence. The dry souls of this day, the dry souls of every season, will find meaning and fulfillment through the Holy Spirit in work in their life. The Holy Spirit moves in our midst this day, calling us to the means of grace, which nurture our body, mind, and soul. The Holy Spirit moves in the midst, offering possibilities of meaning and fulfillment through lives of love and service, through workings for justice, through loving our neighbors, all of our neighbors.
Come, Holy Spirit, set our hearts afire.
Come, Holy Spirit, and nurture these dry souls.
As in the valley of dry bones needed the breath of God to be reanimated, so may the breath of God renew our lives and our congregations.
As the dry hopes of the disciples needed the Holy Spirit to dance in their midst, filling them with courage and hope, so may the Holy Spirit dance in our midst, empowering us with courage and filling us with a dauntless hope.
The dry souls of this day need the breath of God to strangely warm our hearts and ignite within us an unwavering commitment to justice, peace, and compassion.
Come, Holy Spirit, set our hearts afire.
Come, Holy Spirit, set our hearts afire.
Come, Holy Spirit, set our hearts afire.
Come, Holy Spirit, set our hearts on fire.
Amen. Amen.
We will now